You either said it or you didn't. You either said he hit me and punched me or you didn't. Did you say? I did. You did.
I did.
And did he hit you and punch you?
No.
With us now to debate Bill C-422 is a Saskatchewan Conservative MP proposing the legislation, Maurice Vellacott. He joins us from Saskatoon this evening. And here in studio, Marie Gordon, a lawyer practicing family law in Edmonton. And from Calgary, Dr. John Amundson, a child and family psychologist. Welcome to Alberta Primetime, everyone.
Thanks, Jefferson.
Thank you.
I'll start with you, Maurice, just in a nutshell. Explain what this bill proposes and how it differs from the current system.
Well, the present Divorce Act in Canada, the Federal Divorce Act law, has, I think, by a lot of people, authorities and so on, that work in this area, Marie may differ with this, but do agree that there's problems, there's difficulties with this as things stand. And so this bill is attempting to, based on some of the recommendations that came out of the Joint House-Senate Committee report, for the sake of the children, is trying to get at that whole issue of the best interests of children and the presumption, the rebuttable presumption of shared equal parenting, except in cases of proven abuse or neglect. And so the sociological studies and all demonstrate that the best interests of the children are upheld by way of shared equal parenting, different than just simply joint custody, of course. We'll talk about that maybe.
Right.
And so this bill pushes it in that direction as countries, left-leaning countries, more left than we are, but Denmark and Belgium and Norway and Australia is kind of center-right, if you will. But those countries have gone down this road and had some very good success at it. And we believe then for the best interest of children, of moms and dads, and for society generally, that we need to have changes along this line. It's not a perfect bill. Hopefully the kind of adjustments will be made in committee that satisfy many others as well.
Okay, so if I understand this, Marie, what we're looking at is where we currently sit in terms of law, is there really is no presumption of any kind of access to children right off the bat. What this bill would do is give that presumption under law immediately would be 50-50.
Well, that's actually not quite correct, because our divorce law currently talks about one of the priorities that judges should look at is maximizing the amount of time that parents spend with children. So it's really not fair to say that we're starting from zero.
Okay.
We start from a legislative priority that insofar as possible, we should have maximum time with parents. And so I really don't think there's any obstacles right now. It is correct that there's no perfect starting out of the gate presumption about what's best for each individual family. And there are a number of really quite serious problems with a one-size-fits-all presumption for every family. There's also really some serious concerns about what I'm concerned is an ideological issue trumping the best interests and the fact that we start that families are not one size fits all. Every family is different, and there are really some concerns about imposing or forcing on every family a starting place. And so not only do we not need it, I think it's unnecessary given the huge amount of change that we've seen in divorce practice and parenting from 20 years ago when we had very traditional templates. We actually are now, and I act for mums and dads, I act for all sorts of parents, we have a huge variety of arrangements which are determined to meet children's best interests rather than parental rights. So that's the first thing. And the third thing is that we've not only has this been thoroughly vetted before, but there are some real problems in jurisdictions that have actually adopted this. Although Mr. Vellacott makes mention of it working well in Australia, that's actually not what a lot of people have talked about. And in fact, Australian Attorney General is talking about actually pulling back and potentially scrapping this presumption because of the high problems it's caused in high conflict families already, and an increase in acrimonious litigation, which wasn't at all the intention. But when the rubber hits the road, I think it's really important to know that this presumption might sound superficially attractive, like why wouldn't you want parents to spend as much time as possible with children? But when it plays out, there are very serious problems. So,
okay. We'll get into more of these concerns and the specifics of them in a moment. I want to bring into the conversation, John. This is clearly always, we hope anyway, about the best interests of the kids. First, give us a sense of what kids are going through while these processes are happening, and if you think that there is the potential here to sort of increase the challenges and increase the emotional hardship on children as these cases progress.
Yeah, we have to state the obvious. Divorce has a high impact upon children, has an impact on everybody. However, that impact is not necessarily enduring. We know that approximately 80%, lowest number would be 75% of children experience no long-term impact relative to the trajectory of their lives based upon divorce. However, we do know that robust 15 to 20% do. The issue for children then is to say, how do we enroll them in the 75 to 80% group, and how do we prevent them from being enrolled in that 15 to 20% group, right, where there is a long-term impact?
And so do you see the potential of, let's say, more bitter cases in court as having potentially a more negative impact on this experience for the children involved?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, the single most robust factor in predicting the impact of children long term is the management of conflict at the level of the parents. Parents who are good at managing conflict are more likely to have their children in the 80% group. Parents who are not good at that, it doesn't matter, you know. Whatever, you can legislate a frame of reference for them, but if they're not good at lowering conflict. See, children who are exposed to parental conflict are going to say this: if my parents cannot face these strong emotions, how am I as a child going to be able to face these strong emotions?
Okay. I did.
You did?
I did.
And did he hit you and punch you?
No.
Okay.
Not to my recollection.
You knew it wasn't true when you said it, though. I mean, let's be honest.
Yes.
You knew it wasn't true when you said it, right?
Yes.
So you made a conscious decision to embellish the story.
Yes.
And that's a lie. I'm not saying this isn't the biggest creep in the world and you shouldn't divorce him before dark today. I'm not saying that. And I'm not saying that he's not mentally abusive, emotionally abusive, verbally abusive, and even physically abusive. He may deserve
yes.
to be under the jail. I'm not saying that you should put up with that at all under any theory whatsoever. What I'm asking you is, did you or did you not file a false police report when you said that he punched you and hit you, and you knew at the time that he did not?
Yes.
Okay. So this is a long way of coming around to saying, yeah, I lied to the police and got put in jail.